Glory to God. Good morning, each and every one of you. Isn't it good to be in the land of the living, or the land of the breathing anyway? We're really in the land of the dying on our way to the land of the living. You've heard me say that many times before, because this place, this earthly tabernacle that we journey from one day to another, is not going to be our eternity. And even before I get started, I want you to think and contemplate on where your soul rests with the Lord. Have you accepted Jesus Christ as your Savior? Do you know that you know that you know without a shadow of a doubt that if Jesus came back today, that if you were taken in a car accident today, that you would be in the presence of the Lord to stay? Not in the presence of the Lord just for judgment, but you would be in the presence of the Lord to stay. I just thought I needed to say that. Sometimes I would not always say that, and you all don't hear that when you listen to it on YouTube, but I think it's a mandate in this time and season of our lives to make sure that the people that are around you at least have an opportunity to get to know Christ. And if this is the vehicle that God has given me, then I want to make sure that you know Christ, that I'm here not to be famous, for sure. I'm here not to make a name for myself, for sure. But I'm here to lead people to the foot of the cross. And I pray that the things that you have heard in the last few weeks via YouTube, Facebook, wherever you're watching from, that you'll be led to the foot of the cross, that we'll examine our hearts, that we'll examine our minds and our lives, and know that we're right with God. Amen. Hallelujah. But I am so glad to be here. I'm so glad to be here and doing the things of God. That's the thing that makes my heart smile, is being in the presence of the Lord and doing the things of the Lord. So this morning, I want to thank my husband again, that he always gives us a word of wisdom, and he teaches us, and it may be just a little short something that he gives when he reads the scripture, but I appreciate the priest that God has given me, and he knew exactly what I needed, when I needed, and I just want to say that out loud. So we've been trekking and walking and journeying through the first book of the Bible, Genesis. We took a little break last week and we talked about the storm because that was ever present. And those of you who live on the East Coast, some of you are still experiencing the storm. And we are praying for you. We are praying that you recover all. That, you know, the Bible says that you can recover the years that the cankerworm stole, but we pray that you recover the things that are necessary to you to live and to be successful, that you recover those things, that if you don't recover the old things, that God will give you new. We just pray God's blessing upon you, even right now. We're going to turn to Genesis chapter 11. Genesis chapter 11. And I'm going to read 1 through 9. 1 through 9. Who said the Bible has to be boring, huh? I'm telling you, we are putting it out, and we're walking you through it. You may not pick up your word every day and read through it, but we're going to read through it for you, and I'm going to break it down for you, and hopefully we'll get some revelation that will help you in your everyday walk. Verse 1 says, "And the whole earth was of one language and of one speech. And it came to pass, as they journeyed from the east, that they found a plain in the land of Shinar, and they dwelt there. And they said one to another, Go to, and let us make brick and burn them thoroughly. And they had brick for stone, and slime had they for mortar. And they said, Go to, let us build a city and a tower, whose top may reach into heaven, and let us make a name, lest we be scattered abroad upon the face of the whole earth. And the Lord came down to see the city and the tower which the children of men builded. And the Lord said, Behold, the people are one, and they have all one language, and this they begin to do. And now nothing will be restrained from them which they have imagined to do. Go to, let us go down, and there confound their language, that they may not understand one another's speech. So the Lord scattered them abroad from thence unto the face of all the earth, and they left off to build the city. Therefore is the name of it called Babel, because the Lord did there confound the language of all the earth, and from thence did the Lord scatter them abroad upon the face of all the earth. Lord, we just ask that you anoint this presentation of this word, the revelation of the word, anoint the preacher of the word, anoint, Lord God, the hearers of the word, that we may not be just hearers of the word, but we may be doers also. Lord God, we come against every distraction, every cell phone, every Facebook, every Instagram. We come against, Lord God, roast burning in the oven. We come against all those distractions so that we may hear expressly what the Spirit is saying to the church. Have thine own way, Lord. Have thine own way, Lord. Hallelujah. I am the potter, and you're the potter, and I am the clay. Make me a mold, be after thy way. Have your own way, Lord. Have thine own way. Have your way, God, in us on today, Lord. We promise to give you the glory at the end of this story. For it is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 So I was going to actually skip this chapter. You know, some are just a little bit more challenging the other in your mind. In your mind, you think they're just a little bit more challenging, or they're a little bit more, you know. But I stayed on this, and I said, okay, I'm going to, God, as you explain it to me, I will express it to the people. So the Tower of Power, the Tower of Babel, we could call this today, out of Genesis chapter 11, we know that we talked about the flood and the after the flood, and we went into the storm and after the storm, but there was a period of time, a long period of time, from the time that Noah and his family were established on the earth to the time that this particular account takes place. But when the earth's population started growing, they still lived together in one place. And the Bible said that that the earth was replenished through Shem, Ham, and Japheth, the sons of Noah. But they said when they gathered together in one place, they did not go anywhere. They all stayed together as one village, speaking one language. Another interpretation says it means one lip and one words. The same grammar, same vocabulary that they all had. Imagine everybody speaking. Down in Florida, oh my goodness, you have people from all over the world that come, and I can go into one Walmart in one county and don't understand anything that they're trying to say, or go to a hotel in another county and they don't understand what I am saying, and yet we're all in the state of Florida. But as these people started to replenish the earth, as they started to multiply these three sons and their family on the earth, they got the part where they were to be fruitful. They all spoke the same language, they all communicated well together. They got the part where it said that they should be multiplied, but then they got complacent where they were. They stayed right there in that place called Shinar, which there's different translations for what that word means, two rivers and things like that. But nevertheless, that's not the part that I want you to get a hold of today. The land of Shinar, it is one half. Is one half obedience really obedience at all? I was always told, you know, if you're just giving a little bit of obedience, is that really obedience? There's a scripture that I love to say that if you're willing and obedient, then you'll eat the fat of the land. And there's a lot of us that are sometimes willing, but we don't carry through. There's some that carry through, but there are whining and complaining the entire way through. So we miss the fat of the lamb. We may get a little bit of the juices. We may get a little bit of the lean meat of the lamb, but we never get the fat of the lamb. We know where the fat is, there's flavor. Yes, hallelujah. And so is your half obedience, because there are some of us here today, including myself, that there are things that have been told to do, and we go halfway and we think, well, we're all right. We pay half our tithes, we pay half of our offerings, we read the Bible maybe a day of the week. We pray 2 minutes over our meals, but we love so many people, but we don't love everybody else. So are we really, really considered being obedient? And the answer is no. I find this, that rebellion is still running rampant in our world today. Sin came into the world through Adam, and until Jesus comes back, we're always going to have sin with us. We were born in sin and shapen in iniquity. We have all fallen short of the glory of God. Here's the thing. We should not try to purposely fall short of the glory of God. When you fall, that means that you didn't mean to, because you know when you fall, you get hurt. We get tripped up, we fall. But when you purposely set out in your heart to do what is wrong and not to fight and do what is right, then we are in error. But anyway, we're in a rebellious nation. We are in a rebellious world. We have a rebellious generation that is around us. What do we hear all the time? Nobody's going to tell me what to do. You might not say it out loud, but that's in your mind. You're saying, ain't nobody going to tell me what to do. I'm grown. I'm over 21. I'm allowed to vote. I can do whatever I want to do. I make my own money. Nobody is going to tell me what to do. And so we're going to talk a little bit about the difference between complacency versus the outright rebellion, because there's two parts in the Genesis here, and it is complacency. The first one is complacency, kind of being comfortable in your present state, whether it is where God is leading you or God telling you what to do. We just get complacent. Have you ever been blessed? Have you ever survived? I know I could talk about the people in Florida and North Carolina. You've been blessed. You've gone through and survived a serious catastrophe, a catastrophic event. And then you have a real thank you, Jesus moment. Have you ever had a real, like, thank you, Jesus moment, Noah? And then went through the flood and they got off the... I know that was a thank you, Jesus moment. While you were in the midst of your struggle, while you were in the midst of your dilemma, you were real attentive to God. Some of you, it takes us to be in trouble in order for us to really seek out God and seek out what He wants us to do. And at that point, when we were really in trouble, oh, we have no problem praying. We have no problem fasting. We have no problem worshiping and giving God all of our attention. I'm anticipating God's instruction, because we say, God, if you get me out of this, then I promise I will do, I swear I will do that. How many have been in that predicament before? It was just a real thank you, Jesus moment. I mean, I could have been dead. I should have been locked up. The police just whizzed right past me when I was the one that was in trouble. I'm the one that took the overdose, but I'm still standing here. That thank you, Jesus moment, that person was, you thought was pregnant, not pregnant, that thought had the disease, didn't have the disease. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. That the five people in front of you got fired, but you the one that was the lazy, slothful worker, but you kept your job. You had a thank you, Jesus moment. Noah's family, as they survived what had killed everybody else. Some of us listening today, you survived what killed or maimed or handicapped somebody else. Just as his family did, and him and his family shared that thank you, Jesus moment. Noah got drunk on the blessing, go back to a couple of my messages, and then he recovered from his things. And that's the important thing. You may fall and whatnot, but get back up again and recover. And then he worshiped some more. The earth then began to multiply. All was going just fine. It was just going just fine. Shem, Ham, and Japheth, they were able to pour out their seed on the earth and begat. These are generations that happened after the flood to the time that we're speaking now. But as the earth began to multiply, here was the issue. As the earth began to multiply, nobody left to replenish the earth. They started to multiply. They started to have sons and daughters and daughters, but nobody left. Nobody spread it out to replenish the earth. No one wanted to leave their familiar place. We all have a familiar place. We have a place, a comfort zone where we like, and sometimes your comfort zone is really miserable and uncomfortable, but you're familiar with it, and so therefore you stay in that miserable situation, because here it is. You don't know what's out there. You know what's in here, and you know how to handle that on a day-to-day basis. So we stay complacent, and we stay in that place that makes us feel good, that makes us feel safe, that makes us feel all right. How many times, if we don't move according to God's instruction, God had to move you? How many of you out here that God told you to go and you stayed until you couldn't take it anymore? You had to be wounded. You had to be hurt. You had to be taken out before you would go anywhere. You know, you wouldn't rest. You wouldn't take a day off work. You wouldn't take a vacation. You just would not take a break until you landed in the hospital. I don't talk to somebody, you know, you won't walk away from that nasty Susie or player Sammy. You just won't do it. You just won't say no to the frightful friends until you get hurt, until they leave you. And now you're just like, oh, my heart is broken. That God was trying to get you to walk away from those situations long time ago. And because you wouldn't pry your little crinkly arthritic hands off of that thing, he had to move it away from you. You know, God told you to move and you won't leave until you're fired. You won't move until the house catches on fire or the house floods. You just won't go. I'm just not going nowhere. I'm like a tree. Listen, the only time you're supposed to be planted like a tree is if you are in the will of God. Other than that, you need to be movable. You need to be able to be manipulated by God's hand. You need to be moldable. You need to be able to change. You need to be mutable. And God is immutable. He doesn't change. But we need to learn how to change, unless God has to put some circumstances in our lives that finally you will change. Complacency. I'm comfortable because I just don't like change. They didn't want to change. They grew up with their cousins. They grew up making friends. They grew up right where they were, and they did not want to leave there. And so then there is in the account of Genesis chapter 11, there is rebellion. There was complacency first. I don't want to go anywhere, even though God told them to go out and replenish the whole earth. And then there was outright rebellion, because they didn't really want to do what God said. And they must have known that this wasn't going to fly very well. That they knew that the commandment was for them to go out and replenish. So then they just got outright rebellion with it. One thing is to be complacent. Another thing to be outright rebellious. They said rebelliousness is as the sin of witchcraft. How many witches are in the church just rebellious? How many kids are exhibiting the spirit of witchcraft? You'd say, oh no, I would never do witchcraft. But when you're rebellion, it's as the sin. It's still the same. It's just like it. So you need to be careful about what you're rebelling against when it comes to the Lord. They basically said, I'm just not going to do this. I know he's going to check us pretty soon. God's going to say something pretty soon. But I don't know about you. I'm not going. Are you? You going? No. Well, we need to do something about it. We need to stand up and take a stand. We need to be aggressive, and we need to be assertive, and we need to take the helm, and we need to do what we need to do. I'm not leaving Chenier. I've already set up my new house. I've planted new gardens. I've married here. I know Sally down the street and Dave up the road, and I can walk to the corner store with my eyes closed, and nobody bothers me around here because they know me. So let's form a plan. Let's outsmart Noah's God. You see, because it was Noah's God. Noah had a personal relationship with God. He heard his voice. He was obedient to the will of God. But now these are, grandma had a strong religion, but some of these grandchildren and great-grandchildren come just do whatever we want to do. And so we're going to outsmart Noah's God. And that's what people say, well, that was back then. And this is now. And I'll never forget telling my mom, she would say, you can't do this and you can't do that. And I was a teenager and I was thinking, you're keeping me back from mom. You're really keeping me back from having fun. And I was telling her, that happened to you. It's not going to happen to me. And it was rebelliousness. I was rebellious to my mom, because I didn't think she knew what she was talking about, and she was just one out of a few that experienced the things that she did. But I found out that rebelliousness, oh my God, it will get you in places that you got to really pray your way out of. You got to really pray your way out of. And they wanted to outsmart God, just like you all want to outsmart your pastor. You want to outsmart your boss. You want to outsmart God. Yeah, some of y'all so smart, you think you're smarter than God. You think you're smarter than the Word of God. The things that you read, you think is better than the Word of God. We need to be very careful about the things that we rebel against. So what they said was, well, let's take some bricks. Let's make some bricks. And then we're going to take some a slime, and we're going to put together a city. We're going to build a city. We're going to build us a city, and then we're going to build us a tower in the city. We're going to build us a tower, and we're going to build that thing all the way up to heaven. How high is heaven? Come on, y'all. How high can you build a tower to reach into the heavens? Let us make names for ourselves. Oh my, sounds like a generation that is here right now. Let us make names for ourselves so that we won't get scattered. You have to wonder, some of us are building even right now. You've got something that you are building upon. Now, why are you building what you're building? Are you building something to make a name for yourself? Or are you building something for the cause of Christ and the kingdom of God? Is it for God to get glory, or is it for you to get glory? We live in such a vain society, a society full of vanity. You know, I could go on with that for a long time, but this isn't the message. But it's whatever you're putting together, your resume, your business, your group of people that you get, what are you building it for? Is it that you get glory and you become famous and you become known? Or is it for God to be glorified so men will see your good works and then glorify
the Father, because they'll know that it was through God that you were able to do exactly what you were able to do. Are you building something so that you would draw people into the kingdom? So they'll ask you, my God, how did you do that? How did you get there? And you can point to God, oh my God, God gets all the glory. Because you know, God said, I'm not going to share my glory with anybody. I'm not going to share my glory. Matter of fact, the Bible says that no flesh saw glory in his presence. No flesh. So you can get all the shine you want and all the success you want, but it's going to mean nothing when you get before God. Nothing, because he's not going to allow your flesh to be in his presence. He's not going to allow that. So it says that the Lord paid special attention to this, that he paid special attention to what they were doing. Don't think that God doesn't see what you're doing, that he doesn't know the intentions of your heart. God knows your intentions. He knows us. The Bible says, I knew you before you were formed in your mother's womb. I knew how your life was going to be. I knew what you were going to do wrong. I knew whether you would accept me or reject me. I knew that you were going to fall down and get back up. I knew you. And in the spite of knowing you, I anointed you. And I appointed you. And I sanctified you. I looked at the show this morning and seeing Fantasia singing, I know she was anointed to give a word. I know she was anointed to preach. I know she was anointed to evangelize. I know, and she's trying to get her way back to a place, but sometimes the world just takes over and we think we can't do without that. That we built all of this to let it go. To let it go. I built this so I can make a name for myself. Fantasia. So I can have fans all over the place. But she, through her struggles in her life and all the things in her life, she still goes back to remember, my God, those things that happened to me were necessary. Because I wouldn't have learned otherwise. I wouldn't have got it otherwise. If I wouldn't have went through the struggle, the storm, all of the testimony that I have, I would have never came back and been able to shine for God. And some of you, that's what it's going to take. It's going to take tribulation, time, test, and all those troubles in order to bring you back to the foot of the cross. And so they said, we're going to do this, and we're going to make a name for ourselves, and we're going to build this thing so high. We're going to, you know, they had vision. And you know what I was thinking? I was thinking, well, isn't it a good thing when people all come together in unity? I think that's what used to confuse me about the story. It was like, why would God get mad when, you know, he calls for unity and he's telling us to be in the same mind and all that? Why would God? There is power in unity. There is power in agreement. There is power. The Bible says where two or three gathered together in my name, he would be in the midst, and we could touch and agree on things concerning this earth, and it shall be done. That one can chase 1,000 and two can chase 10,000. Look at that multiplication. It is powerful for unity. So I was thinking, well, what's the big deal, God? Until I got the whole idea that it was for the wrong purposes. And they were being disobedient in the whole thing. Because you can be powerful in unity. That's the KKK. They're unified in their belief in what they're doing. Ask some of the witches out there that have their groups of witches out there. They're unified in what they do. There are a lot of groups out there that have came together and become very powerful because they agreed. But we have to learn how to base our unity and our agreement off of what God is saying. Only then that would God be glorified. Only then will God be pleased. Only then will God be able to do something great and mighty. When you decide to take your name off of it, when you decide to take your shine off of that thing, then God, hallelujah, is able to bless. But in this place, they weren't being unified together to do the will of God. They were doing their own thing. So God took notice of it. And again, I say, God sees our rebellion. He sees our complacency. He sees when you're building kingdoms that are not of him and for you and for the world. And so he came down, it says, to see. I'm just going, and yes, God is all omniscient. He sees everything. He knows everything. But he said, I'm going to come down and see it. I'm going to show you that I see it. It's one thing to know that your mom knows that you did something wrong, but when they walk into the room and they want you to see that they see what you're doing, grandmas used to scare us like that. When they come into the room, you'd be bragging about anything else, and just them being there. He said, no, they need to see me see them doing this. They need to see me seeing them. So let's go down and see the city and the tower. Come down, let us come down, and when we get down there, we got a plan too. See, you got a plan, but God has a plan. You can fight God's plan all you want, trying to have your way and trying to do your thing, but you'll fail. You will totally fail because God is, he is all powerful. He's all powerful and he is able, hallelujah, to take your plan out. He said, he came down, he said, come let us go down there and confound their language. They were all communicating well. They were all talking the same language. Nobody had to get a translator. Nobody had to get an interpreter. Nobody had to do sign language. No one had to do any of that type of thing. They were on one accord. But then God said, this isn't good because they're using this unity to come against the kingdom. He caused them to do language. Now, I was reading one of the writers that was writing on this particular subject because I was just trying to get a little bit of understanding myself. But he was talking about, and he painted a picture that was really great. He said, imagine being on a construction site. Imagine being on a construction site and you're building something and it's glorious and it's beautiful. It's going to be the next, whatever landmark in the land. And all of a sudden, you all have the same plans, you all have the same, and then all of a sudden, you open up your mouth to talk to the one that's working on your right, and you can't understand them, and they can't understand you. I was able to understand them this morning, but for some reason, I'm talking, and I'm not talking the same language they're talking. And then over here, over the people working on the roof say, I can't understand what the boss is saying. I can't understand what the foreman is saying, and the foreman can't understand what I'm saying. Imagine that day, how everything shifted, everything changed in their lives on that day. It caused so much separation. It was more separation than the Great Wall of China created. I mean, it was just like, so then, the picture he paints, he said, okay, then they say, well, something's going on really crazy. I got to get somewhere where somebody understands what I'm saying. So they run home and talk to their wives and children, and they are all talking their language. They understand that. But then they look out, try to talk to the neighbors, and the neighbors don't understand what they're saying. I don't understand. We woke up this morning. We talked about the morning news. We talked about what happened on Wall Street. We talked about all of those things, and now all of a sudden, I don't understand what they're saying, and they're speaking in some other type of, as the interpretation said, lip. They're speaking in some type of other words that I don't understand. So they all started gathering with whoever sounded like them. And so, because they couldn't understand each other, they had no choice but to separate. When God's response, when they said, let us build a tower, God's response was, well, let us confound their language then. They want to be smart. Let's confound their language. At this construction site, it became mass chaos. to the point where they call the city Babel, which means blah, 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 confusion. Babbling. Confusion. What's the city you live in? What's your environment called? Are you living in an environment of confusion where you don't understand, nobody understands you, and you don't understand them, and everything is topsy-turvy? Where do you reside at? And what are you going to do about where you reside at? Because God always gives us an opportunity to get to the place where he has called us to in the first place. Why can't we just be obedient, everybody? Why can't we just be obedient? Why are we afraid even of obedience to God when we should really fear not being obedient? You know, God does say some really strange things to us sometimes. And it's so strange that you're afraid to tell your neighbor. You're afraid to tell your spouse. You're afraid to tell your children. You're afraid. I remember when God told me that I was going to preach, I didn't want to tell my family. I didn't want to tell my mom. Because we grew up in an environment where women just didn't preach. And every Sunday we heard it from the pulpit verbatim, word for word. And if you're a woman and you say you're called to preach, you're a liar and the truth ain't in you. And I would sit on the front row and listen to that on a regular basis. And all of a sudden God spoke that thing, and I was afraid. I was afraid to tell my pastor. I was so afraid because I have moved since then. I moved after that from some church hurt, and I moved, and so I had this other pastor, and my pastor, God knows, he made it really easy for me because my pastor had also heard from God, and he said, what is God calling you really to do? And I had to write it on a piece of paper. I couldn't even say it out loud. But I had to do it because every time I was going to school at the time, and one of my friends was in school, and I would just cry through the whole classes. All the classes, I would just cry and weep when we talked about the anointing and the calling and just the gifts of the Spirit and all those different classes that I would just cry, and she would pat me on the back. She would look up at the teacher and she would say, but I was so afraid. I was afraid of obedience. Imagine that. I was afraid of obedience. And let me tell you something, what obedience did for me. Obedience changed my life. Obedience gave me strength. Obedience gave me favor. Obedience did so much for, you know, in obedience, God rewards obedience. He gave me favor. He blessed my socks off. To the point when I did say that, my pastor said, oh, yeah, that makes sense. My mom said, oh, right. You didn't know that? You've been doing it since you were a kid. You were doing it even when you were directing the choir. You were doing it in Sunday school. You were doing it in the kitchen. You were doing it among your friends. You were doing it with the little kids that you babysat all the time. You were already doing that. And the enemy would want you to be afraid of the unknown. And he would want to make you feel like, nobody's going to receive that. Noah, imagine if Noah would have never listened to the word and the voice of the Lord and was not obedient, but rebellious as the ones that died in the flood. Imagine what Abraham would have been, which we're going to talk about next week. Imagine if Abraham wouldn't have left his home and went to the land. I mean, his seed multiplied. We're the sons and daughters of Abraham. Imagine if Jesus wasn't obedient to the Father. Hallelujah. Oh my God. Obedient to step down through generations off of his throne in glory. Hallelujah. To come down to a lowly stable. To come to a place where they would reject him. Obedient to get up on that cross and stay there and take the beating and take the mockery and take all the... Imagine if Jesus wasn't obedient. We wouldn't have the salvation that we have right now because obedience stood out the most of me on the cross. Yes, it was love, but I can love a whole lot of people and still not be obedient. I can love you, but I'm not going to die for you. I can love you, but I'm not going to give you my last. different. It's a cognitive decision that I'm going to do it regardless of the worldly consequences. I'm going to do what God says to do. If you are obedient, if you're willing and obedient, then and only then will you eat of the fruit of the Lamb. We're not being blessed. We're not being favored. We're not receiving what God already had planned for us because we're not obedient. Yes, you come to church. Yes, you come to Bible study. But there's so many other things in the Word of God that it tells us that we need to do in obedience to God. You can build all you want. You can build up your reputation. You can build up your career. You can build up your business. I don't care how many children and grandchildren you got. You can build up your legacy. You can build up your bank account. You can build up all of those things. But the Bible says in Psalms 127:1, build all you want, but except the Lord build the house, the builders labor in vain. Unless the Lord watches over the city, the guards watch in vain. They watch in vain. So what are you building? Are you building it according to God's will? Are you building it according to God's word? We need to get back to the places where God told us to go. Do the things. Forget about what people think. Forget about them calling you crazy. Forget about it. Focus on what God has spoken to you to do. When we start being obedient, God will bless you. I can't wait to talk about Abraham next week and probably the week after because of his obedience, because of the obedience of David, because of the obedience of so many of these, of Moses, of Joshua, of Jesus, of Peter, of all of those, of Apostle Paul, of obedience of them is the reason why we can read about it today, the reason why we can be encouraged. Your obedience, hallelujah, may help somebody 15 years down the road, may help somebody 20 years down the road. Your obedience in this season, God is calling for obedience. You all be blessed and stand on your feet, please.